those of you know that PJ is a gardener extreme, be in prayer for her because she Friday afternoon putting up some jars, she kind of fell and did the splits. It wasn't good. And then finally was able to get up in the morning this morning, go out into the greenhouse, and some rat has gone in there and eaten everything she planted. Dug up seeds and everything. Yeah. Needless to say, she's not happy right this minute. But this has been a week that the devil's tried to get everybody, and I'm not talking about our family, I'm talking about everybody. The devil tried to get everybody so busy they haven't got time to be with God. I know that trying to keep everybody fed and happy at our place, trying to keep all the animals in, all these things that God has got me busy. Devil's got me busy. And at times, you feel so separated from God that you feel like, what's going on, God? Well, the thing is, our relationship with God is kind of like there was an old man and his wife was driving down the road. He was driving, and his wife was sitting over here looking out the window, and they passed by a couple, young couple, either newlyweds or just dating or something. But he was driving with one arm was like this, and she was all snuggled up to him, and she said, whatever happened, we used to be just like that. The old man sitting there said, I ain't never moved. So, that's kind of like the way God is. God, what happened? Where are you? And he's sitting there saying, I ain't moved yet. I'm still here. Where are you at?
I'm going to say that the way.
So we get to thinking, people say, and there are lots of beliefs in this world. Some people believe that you can accept Christ as your Savior, be in a good relationship with Him, and then step on your tongue or something, and oops, you're not saved anymore. That doesn't make sense to me. Absolutely no sense at all. And I know this because in Matthew, that's not Matthew, that's actually Matthew, 7th chapter, starting in 21. I'll wait for you to turn there. Matthew 7, 21. We are turning, we are swiping, we are just looking with blank stares. There was homework? Alright, Matthew 7, 21. It says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did I not prophesy in your name? Did I not cast out demons or perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Well, you just said that if I don't do the will of the Father, that I can't go to heaven, right? Absolutely. The will of the Father is you to have a relationship with Him through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is the will of the Father. Now, there's lots of other things. Messing myself up here. There's lots of other things that God wants you to do to engage with Him in this relationship. Now, that old couple that was driving down the road were still married. Okay? They were sitting on separate ends of the car, separate sides of the car. And when they went to church, one probably sits here and the other probably sits over there. But they're still married. Just because good. We have a house that was built in the mid-60s. And every once in a while, the toilet, which, by the way, judging by the date stamped on the inside, is a vintage 1966 USA made toilet. And that little flapper, you know, the string or the thing holding that flap together, jumps off. Well, I'm going to go fix it. I lift the lid, and PJ said, every time this happens, PJ says, don't drop that lid. And I get in there and I fix it. And I reach over to pick up that lid and it slips out of my hand about that far off the floor. And that's all it takes. That rascal busted into a million pieces. I looked at it and I said, ouch. Loudly. Don't bother working. And PJ says, what happened? But I dropped the lid. But now I see her. Oh! So.
Carried with myself that time.
Now I have to switch out a toilet. This was Friday. I have to switch out a toilet that was put in 1966. Do you know how hard it is to put a modern toilet in a vintage hole?
Yep.
It don't work that easy. Steve called me and says, how long is it going to take you to set that thing? Man, you don't even try that one. It's going to take the rest of the night, isn't it? It took a while. But, do you have a few trips to the hardware store? But, the thing is, PJ was mad as a teased hornet. Because he just told me, don't drop that lid. And I was mad at myself. And kind of took it out on her with my mild Irish temper. But the thing is, we're still married. I messed up. We had an argument. But we're still married. It didn't cause a divorce. Now, not saying that she didn't contemplate murder, but we have both told each other bullets are way too cheap for a divorce. Really. So, not saying that she didn't contemplate choking me or something, but it didn't end our relationship. So here Christ is saying that in the end times, when I come back, people are going to stand before me and say, Lord, I was a preacher. I was an evangelist. I've got 10,000 people that come to you. And Christ is going to say, maybe you should have started with yourself. Make sense? Those other 10,000, great. Wonderful. You should have started with yourself. Because you didn't have a relationship with me. You just acted like you did. So, does that mean that I can fall away? No. Because there's something, one thing that God cannot do. Absolutely impossible. God cannot lie. Anybody disagree? God cannot lie. When I have a relationship with God, He knows me, I know Him. I have a relationship with most everybody in here. I know almost everybody. I probably know everybody, but I have to meet you about 6 or 8 times before I actually remember you. But it has nothing to do with you. It's the neurons that are blowing through my mind at Mach 3. So, I have a relationship with you. I know you. When I walk away and somebody says, hey, do you know Lisa Gibson? No. I don't. I would lie, right? Maybe sometimes she thinks, man, I wish he didn't, but that's beside the point. God cannot lie when he says, away from me, I never knew you. I never knew you. That's impossible. He can't know me today and forget about me tomorrow. I've tried several times to explain this, and something came up on my phone. I get a Bible verse that comes up on my phone every day. And in Romans 8:35, I saw something that really stuck with me, and I really like it. I had to save it so I could remember it. And as I work on my sermon throughout the week, God gives me scripture. But I don't always have a pen with me. So at the end of the week, I'm like, oh man, what was that verse? So I have to like write it down or put it in my phone or something. But he says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height, depth, nor anything else in creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's as plain as you can get it. Paul, who did some horrendous things, he was persecuting the followers of the one true living God, his son, Jesus Christ. He was putting them in jail, killing a few. He was doing bad things, and God knocked him on his knees. Funny thing about that, when he was on the road to Damascus, the light shone, and he fell to the ground, and a voice came up and said, Saul, why do you persecute me? What did he say? Who are you, Lord? First thing he said, Lord, who are you? Yeah, right. You know me. You know who I am. Why are you persecuting me? And then he took him to go to the straight street there in Damascus, and he sent a prophet to him, a disciple to him, and he evangelized him. He saved him. He made him a disciple. And then he said, you're not going to go to the synagogues. You're not going to go where you're comfortable going and talking to people. You're going to go out where you're not comfortable talking to people, and you're going to do what I want you to do. You will suffer many agonies for my sake. Now, we don't have to suffer the persecution that the first Christians did. I'm not saying we won't. I'm not saying that in this country of freedom that one day they might take that freedom from us and we might suffer persecution. But right now, we're free to follow our Lord Jesus Christ. So, what can separate us from God? Paul sat there and said, nothing. Not a sword, not height, nor depth, nor nakedness, nor anything can separate us from God. The nakedness part, when Adam and Eve was in the garden and they ate the fruit, they covered themselves with leaves, and they hid from him. God said, hey, why are you hiding? You can't run from God. I've said many times, God said, I will never leave nor forsake you. And that was a challenge. Nobody ever took me up on that. See if you can tell me how many times in the Bible God said, I will never leave or forsake you. There's a whole lot of them. I will never leave you. I will never leave you. Nothing can separate you from me. Now, our sin makes us feel like we're separated. And we can try to separate ourselves from God. I tried for a lot of years. But it just didn't work. It's that conviction. It's that thing like, man, I really know I shouldn't be doing this, but, well, that's conviction, folks. That's the Holy Spirit saying, hey, dummy, stop. Don't do this. It's a quiet voice. My father and mother, two completely different styles of discipline. I forget who told me, but this is the way my father is. And I believe it was someone here. I cannot forgive me about. But anyway, there was a man with his grandkids. And this is a true story. I just can't remember who told me. A man with his grandkids, and his grandchild was trying to get him to do something. The grandpa said, no, we're not doing that. I said, Grandpa, you know, times have changed. And he said, yeah, but the way they make leather hasn't. That was my dad's style. Okay. You mess up, I will correct you in the way that you need to be corrected. I will, if I have to holler at you, I'll holler at you in the middle of Walmart. I don't care. If I have to bust your backside, everybody's going to see it. You embarrass me, I embarrass you right back. Kind of all those Texas laws, you kill somebody in Texas, they kill you back. You remember that thing? Yeah. You embarrass me, I embarrass you right back, right there in front of Walmart. Or whack! The most dreaded sound of us children was the sound of that leather flapping as Daddy pulled his belt off. That hurt worse than the actual spanking. Because you knew it. It's like, oh no. So, my mother, we would beg her to spank us. Because she was sitting there and she talked to me in this tiny voice. She would never raise her voice, never yell or scream or get a belt out or anything. And by the time she's been talking, like 2 minutes into it, you're like blubbering like a baby. You're like, would you just please tell Dad? So he can spank me and get it over with. No. That's how the Holy Spirit works. He talks to you in a very still, calm voice. And he said, hey, you know you're not supposed to be doing this. Maybe you should stop and, I don't know, pray? Read the Bible? Go seek some friends who aren't doing this? Maybe you should do that. And then we hear that, we process it, and the draw of sin just pulls us away. Well, there you go. Now we've separated ourselves from God. No, we haven't. Now we have just grabbed the Holy Spirit, put our arm around Him, and said, come! And that's what we've done. Why do we do these things? I'm impressed with this fight. Why do we do these things? It's because sin gets in our brains and pulls us away. Paul himself said, you know, the things I do, I don't want to do. And the things that I don't do, I want to do. And if I do the things I don't want to do, it's not me that's sinning, it's the sin that lives in me. Because we are infused with sin from the moment we're conceived. I don't care how godly a person is, we all sin. And from the moment we're conceived, we are conceived a sinful creature. Simply because of Adam and Eve, all those years ago, messed it up for all of us. But Christ came into the world and gave us a way out of it. Do we still sin? Yes. Does that sin separate us from God? No. I've had people say, but the Bible says don't kill. The Bible also says don't gossip. And I love the, what they're called, seven mortal sins or deadly sins or something like that. Because these are worse than these sins. You know what? No, they're not. Telling the smallest white lie is exactly the same as mass murder in the eyes of God. Sin is sin is sin. Does it separate us? No. There is absolutely nothing my children can do to make me disown them. Absolutely nothing. There's nothing that I can do to make my parents disown me. Nothing. And if we, as broken people, as flawed people, can love that much, imagine how much more our Savior can love us. How much more can God love the ones He created than we can love each other? You know what they call that, right? When we sin and we feel separated from God? I think the medical term is separation anxiety. Yeah? We get all anxious because God's not hearing us. God's not, oh God. I've been praying and you haven't been answering my texts. Haven't been answering my email. God, what's going on? Do you not love me anymore? God's saying, hey, idiot, shut up and you'll hear me. Just close your mouth, open your ears, and listen. Something I had to learn as a kid. My dad would usually let me rant. Say, why didn't you tell me about that? He said, I actually did. You were running your head and didn't listen. So now clean up what you messed up. To get that inseparable bond with God. To get something that no one and no thing can separate you from. To get that one piece of the puzzle that's going to fill a void that you're needing. It's a simple prayer. It's a simple act of introducing yourself to someone. I would never be married today had I not introduced myself to my wife in Walmart. Yes, you can get anything in that store. If I had not introduced myself to my wife, I would not be married today. Sometimes she wonders why I did introduce myself, but I'm kind of glad I did. It's going to be the same way when you start a relationship with God. You're going to say, wow, why did I do this a long time ago? And you're never going to say, I wish I hadn't done this. And I did misspeak. There's one thing you cannot get in Walmart, and that's salvation. You have to get that through Christ. I saw you look at me when I said that. One thing you cannot get, you have to get salvation through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There's a way of doing it. It's just a prayer. It's a simple, short, easy prayer. You just talk to Him like you talk to your friend, because He is your best friend. Follow me in a prayer. Lord, I know I've sinned. I've done things You said I shouldn't do. Lord, I've separated myself from You, and I haven't been able to get back to You, no matter how hard I try. But now I know that Christ died on the cross to give me that bond that, is better than any glue that, they made. And I will never be separated from you again, Lord. I ask you into my heart, into the sin out. Fill me up with your Holy Spirit. Lord, I love you. I confess you as my Savior. I want you to walk with me here on earth. Lead me right into heaven. But as the saints in your name.